two. Did we say we'd go into the lovers' night?
No.
Finish up.
Yeah. We were going to finish the park.
Okay. Okay, we played with the parkers. And, kind of need a term for this.
Get in his own book, Bart.
Yeah.
Looks like the answer.
I'm gonna call this the correction of Wren's language. Goes through blocks. We could put terms of structure, redefinitions. But what's going on behind it, behind these alternative redefinitions of the argument? Is a correction of the French language. It takes two forms. One is, as it proceeds, he's forced to become clearer in his language. Clearer only in the sense that he becomes clearer about his judgments. Not that the argument becomes clearer. And so that the increasing clarity as the dialogue proceeds reveals the friend's real class of judgments, what's really behind his position. So as it becomes clear about his judgments, his own position emerges. And he turns out to confuse two orders of thinking. He is basically a moralist. He's using a certain kind of moralistic. His own position emerges. His moralistic stance can be viewed in the terms he uses. The moralistic stance becomes clear in the terms he selects to express his position. And Socrates picks this up right from the beginning, doesn't he? Picks this up right from the beginning.
So let's go with school, all right?
Readers and push through. And see the effect that this has on the dialogue.
What was the other form? There were two forms of correction of the friend's lines.
Yeah.
What was the second?
If there is the philosophical position, it needs to be correct.
So there's two. There's a contrast you're making between, his language would be cleaned up as a function of his seeing.
That's right. There's two things going on, two levels going on. Socrates is exploring a logical position, or I could call it a philosophical position. He's exploring the philosophical position logically to make it more accurate, right? He's exploring philosophical position that contains a non-philosophical language. So he has to purify that. So it has two levels. His friend has two levels. He's presumably maintaining a philosophical position, but his language is replete with the kind of language that prevents him from reasoning philosophically. So Socrates has to sift out the one language to continue in the purely philosophical. Let's try it, shall we?
I was curious as to whether this was a, remember, is this a way of exploring someone who holds that basic light-dark duality?
Yes.
Which is what you, I was taught.
Which is what you were taught.
In a sense of, you know, that there are bad guys who are evil.
Yeah.
Right.
There's a moral indignation. Mm-hmm. It expresses itself in a certain language. And that blocks any kind of understanding. Because once you express moral indignation about the position, then it's done with it. Well, what do you need after that? Socrates says, you need a lot. But you don't understand it. The word you're upset about a position doesn't mean you understand it. You know, after you finish calling someone wicked, okay. Very nice if you're calling him wicked. Now, should we go back and see about the issue?
It's a work of Satan.
Yeah.
Here? What?
Double bid, do.
Okay.
Yeah.
What are the two positions again here? I think that was the philosophical. What was the other?
Moral. Oh. Non-philosophical, the moral. Who would like to play?
Harry.
Great.
Which one?
The friend.
We need the Socrates. Where did you just volunteer? Huh?
Yes.
Good. Now, you know what that requires, though? Speaking on.
All right.
Okay. Just throw your voice a bit.
And
the lights, camera, action.
And what is love of gain? What can it be? And who are the lovers of gain?
In my opinion, they are those who think it worthwhile to make gain out of things of no worth.
Is it your opinion that they know those things to be of no worth, or do not? Or if they do not know, you mean that the lovers of gain are fools?
No, I do not mean they are fools, but rascals who wickedly yield to gain, because they know that the things out of which they dare to make their gain are worthless, and yet they dare to be lovers of gain from mere shamelessness.
Okay. What kind of language is that?
Sneer.
That's all
moralistic.
Moralistic.
Shame and
they
evil.
Wickedly dare.
Mm-hmm.
Shameless. Sounds like the Baptist church. Yeah.
What is Socrates going to do? Now, if you buy into that, the discussion is ended. If you accept those terms and use them, the dialogue's over. Right, as an example, did he answer the point?
This is just like a Farkas thing, just like the digression.
It's just like the digression.
Don't be fooled. Well, that's the other word's function.
Yeah. Let me ask you. All right. Socrates just had some very interesting questions. Were they answered in that section?
No, just the last one. Who are the lovers of gain?
But did he answer who they are?
No, he attempted to answer the last question.
No, see, when you say he attempted.
Well, he didn't select. Well, yeah, he said he answered who are the lovers of gain.
Okay, then they're bad people.
In his opinion?
Yeah, they're bad people. Now, we want to know whether that answers who they are.
Oh, I see. No,
it may. No, no. Don't take out of it. Say it. Hold on.
It's in his opinion.
Okay, what's Socrates' question?
What is love of gain and what can it be?
Do they know? Do they know?
Oh, that question?
Or are they ignorant? When they seek to make gain of things of no worth, do they know those things have no worth? Or are they ignorant of those things? Are they ignorant of the things that have no worth? Are they ignorant of the fact that they're worthless? For if they do not know, you mean the lovers of gain, are fools. Why would that follow? Why does he say that? See, look at the way he structured it. Is it your opinion that they know those things to be of no worth or not know? Do they know or don't they know? Huh? Look here. They're no worth. Socrates says, hey, you know what? Man, only a fool. Only a fool would do that.
Gain something that's worth it.
No, not gain something that's worthless.
Knowingly.
Yeah, make a gain of things of no worth.
Mm-hmm.
Why would that make them a fool? Mike, what did you say?
Well, if there's no worth, there's no gain, really.
There's no worth to it. Only a fool would think he can gain or something of no worth.
Yeah.
There couldn't be any intelligence then.
That's a fool, isn't it? Right?
Like
agree? Jen?
Mm-hmm. Bart? Just like someone who took bags of garbage to the swap meet and attempted to sell them for, you know, turn a fair profit if they were just bags of trash and banana peels and... Here they are, ladies and gentlemen.
They can sell the swap meet side them, too.
Well, it comes close, I gotta admit it.
Just find a greater fool.
Right.
Can there be a person, truly, who knows that he's trying to make a gain of things of no worth?
I don't think there.
You say, you know what? If they know that, then they're fools. Right, they're just fools if they know that things of no worth, and that's the kind of stuff they're trying to make a gain of. Then it'd be cool. So what is his answer? No. I do not mean they're fools, but rascals who wickedly yield to gain, because they know that the things out of which they dare to make their gain are worthless, and yet they dare to be lovers of gain for mere shamefulness.
He's been taken.
He's been taken. He's upset.
If you read this to the rhetoric, the way that guy did the Mary Had a Little Lamb, it would really go down.
Yeah. Read it.
I do not mean they are fools, but rascals who wickedly yield to gain, because they know that the things out of which they dare to make their gain are worthless, and yet they dare to be lovers of gain from mere shamelessness.
Hmm. Who is this?
So Sock comes back?
Jerry Falwell.
Sock comes back and says...
Oh, well now, do you mean by the lover of gain such a man, for instance, as a farmer who plants something which he knows is a worthless herb and thinks fit to make gain out of it when he has reared it up? Is that the sort of man you mean?
The lover of gain, as such, Socrates, thinks he ought to make gain from everything.
Okay. What did Socrates do after that?
That's rhetorical speech.
What did he do?
What do you mean by...
He didn't play into it at all.
He didn't take any of those terms. Wicked, rascal.
Right. And did he... Yeah, but now did he try to supply the who?
Mm-hmm.
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 Yeah.
Yeah.
Now each is supplying a who. Only Socrates is saying, look, if I just take your position as true and strip it from all of the verbiage, it doesn't add anything content-wise to your position. And then look for an example for it. Would this be a natural example for such a person? A farmer now, if a farmer proceeded in that way.
Mm-hmm.
Is that what he's doing? Therefore, he's ignoring that, isn't he? Now, what does that do to his friend? The last utterance.
He's still mad, still there.
He's still mad. See, there's anger there, isn't there?
Maybe even angrier.
Yeah, so he's drawing it.
Clearly.
That's right.
Everything.
He was ripped off.
The lover of gain thinks he ought to make gain from everything.
The type of person, you know, the kind of person, those kinds of people, they try to make a gain from everything. Well, then, look at that. Suddenly changed, didn't it?
Yeah.
Because it would include things of worth, things of no worth.
Includes everything.
Everything.
So he's angry.
Gain out of anything.
Yeah, now he's just angry, isn't he? Yeah. Well, then how do you deal with an angry man? So Sock picks it up, so right away. Sock in the back.
Please do not speak so recklessly, as though you had been wronged by someone. But give me your attention and answer just as you would if I were beginning my question over again. Do you not admit that the lover of gain has knowledge of the worth of the thing from which he thinks it worthwhile to make gain?
I do.
So what did he do?
Brings it back.
Brings it back and he calls him on. You know what you sound like? You sound like someone who went back. And it's just as weird, disgusting. Have you been wronged by someone? Right? Look what he's telling him. Give me your attention and answer just as you would if I were beginning my questions over again. Mm-hmm. Hey, wake up. Give me your attention. Right? What's the state of the issue? Is that what he's doing?
Yeah, instead of going off on his anger, he's focusing on the question.
Well, our friends would do that.
Okay, that's very likely. All right, now it's restated. Notice the way he restates it. Socrates, do you not admit that the lover of gain has knowledge of the worth of the thing from which he thinks it worthwhile to make gain? Right? Mm-hmm. He's taking this. They do know. Right? Don't they know? Don't they have knowledge of the worth of the thing from which he thinks it worthwhile to make gain? Mustn't he? Mustn't he have the knowledge of the worth of... Mustn't he not have knowledge of the worth of the thing he seeks to make a gain?
Sure. There would be no motive otherwise.
There must be some.
No intelligence here.
There's no intelligence. So now it's very straight. Now it's straight again. And what happens to his friend now in all this rhetoric?
He's uses less words.
I do. Now he's on the philosophical track for a while.
Then who has knowledge of the worth of plants and of the sort of season and soil in which they are worth planting? If we choose to may throw in one of those artful phrases which have dropped leaders, adroit leaders used to trick out their speeches in the lock boards.
For my part, I should say a farmer.
Right, and that goes back precedingly. Remember when he ducked that, when the example of a farmer was made on the preceding page. So it's all back. I'm with you now. Yeah, okay. Damn it. Mm-hmm. Can't stay angry.
And by think it worthwhile to make gain, do you mean ought but? Thinking one ought to make gain?
I mean that.
Then do not attempt to deceive me, who am now quite an elderly person, and you so young, by making, as you did just now, an answer that is not even your own thought. But tell me in all truth, do you suppose that any man who has taken up farming and who knew it was a worthless plant, that he was planting, could think to make gain from it?
Upon my word, I do not.
Or again, take a horseman who knows that he is providing worthless food for his horse. Do you suppose he is unaware that he is destroying his horse?
I do not.
But he does not think to make gain from that worthless food?
No.
Or again, take a navigator who has furnished his ship with worthless spars and ropes. Do you think he is unaware that he will suffer for it? And will he be in danger of being lost himself and of losing the ship and all for a cargo?
I do not.
So he does not think to make gain from that worthless tackle?
No, indeed.
But does a general, who knows that his army has worthless arms, think to make gain or think it worthwhile to make gain from them?
By no means.
Or does a flute player who has worthless flutes, or a harper with a lyre, or a bowman with a bow, or anyone else at all, in short, among ordinary craftsmen or sensible men in general, with any implement or other equipment of any sort that is worthless, think to make gain from?
To all appearance, no.
He's sneaking a little bit back, right? He's coming back a little bit. Right?
Then whoever can be, can they be, your lovers of gain? For I presume they are not the people whom we have successfully mentioned, but people who know they're worthless things, and yet think they can, they are to make gain from them. But in that case, by what you say, remarkable sir, no man alive is a lover of gain.
That's his conclusion. It's over. Want to go back and do it again?
Then whoever can they be, your lovers of gain? For I presume they are not the people whom we have successfully mentioned, but people who know they're worthless things, and yet think they are to make gain from them. But in that case, by what you say, remarkable sir, no man alive is a lover of gain.
Unless he is a total fool. No one can be that stupid. Darn, it's over. Mm-hmm. Right? So his friend comes back.
Well, Socrates, I should like to call those lovers of gain who from insatiable greed consumedly long for things that are even quite pretty and of little or no worth, and so love gain in each case.
What's he doing then?
Calling the names again.
It's now going back to the old style, isn't it? Right? Well, Socrates, I should like to call those lovers of gain who from an insatiable greed consumedly long with things that are even quite petty and of little or no worth, and so love gain in each case. Got a picture of him there? What is it?
Angry.
Right, he's still angry. But he, you know, what Socrates just concluded is that, hey, you know, by your idea of a lover of gain, there's no one in that class. What is he saying to him?
I'm still angry. Well, he's given him a little bit. There's a little bit of worth.
There's a little bit. So he has to, right? He has to give just a little bit.
Right.
Right? So now that a little bit of worth is permitted, Socrates is going to take that. So that's the second case, isn't it? Hey, you know what? Same argument's going to apply. Mm-hmm. Same argument. No worth or very little worth, you know?
Same thing.
Same argument. So Sock comes back.
Not knowing, of course, my excellent friend, that the things are worthless. For we have already convinced ourselves by our argument that this is impossible.
I agree.
And if not knowing this, clearly they are ignorant of it. And if not knowing this, clearly they are ignorant of it, but think that those worthless things are worth a great deal.
Apparently.
Right.
Now, of course, lovers of gain must love gain.
Yes.
And by gain, you mean the opposite of loss.
I do.
And is it a good thing for anyone to suffer loss?
For no one.
Rather an evil?
Yes.
So mankind are harmed by loss?
They are harmed.
Then loss is an evil?
Yes.
And gain is the opposite of loss?
The opposite.
So that gain is a good?
Yes.
Hence, it is those who love the good that you call lovers of gain.
So it seems.
At least, there is nothing mad, my friend, about lovers of gain as you describe them. But tell me, do you yourself love or not love whatever is good?
I love it.
And is there anything good that you do not love, or must it then be?
Upon my word, nothing.
In that respect, you love all good things.
Yes.
Well, now, ask me on my side whether I do not likewise. For I shall agree with you, for my part, that I love good things. But besides you and me, do you not think that all the rest of mankind love good things and hate evil things?
It appears so to me.
And we admitted that gain is good.
Yes.
On this new showing, everyone appears to be a lover of gain. Whereas, by our former way of arguing, no one was a lover of gain. So on which of the two arguments are we to rely in order to avoid error?
What has to be done, I think, Socrates?
I'm going to do another.
Or you have to give up one or the other, and one is absurd. So now he's stuck. Go ahead.
What has to be done, I think, Socrates, is to conceive the lover of gain rightly.
Good.
The right view of the lover of gain is that he is one who concerns himself with and thinks fit to make gain from things from which honest men do not dare to make gain.
Right. New position. Right? Mm-hmm. It's coming out more, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But you see, my sweet sir. Mm-hmm.
Just one second. The things fit to make gain from it, as far as I can see, it's still that wording, things to make gain.
And things fit, things it worthy to make gain?
Yeah, I think so, from what I can see. Mm-hmm.
You see, that's in the auxiliary.
Mm-hmm. Make gain. Care gain.
Care gain.
Care gain. Care gain.
If it's not, he's not translating it, then it should be a cousin fit. Because that's the term that's all the way through.
This guy's
going to
be hard on the ground. He's not doing anything.
Yeah. Well, he isn't very helpful if he takes fit over worthy.
Mm-hmm.
Oxioi, the schoolboy translation is to think good.
Right.
So, whether or not you're going to go all the way with good on oxioi, which then I meant more of a contextual now.
But it is the term he's been translating worthy all the way through.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's a common translation.
Worthy.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Probably safer with things fit unless you're really going to go with a contextual note.
Well, he didn't reply to the last question.
So we can keep going with it.
Yeah.
That's right, isn't it?
He's going to modify the position.
There's still that honest man do not dare to make gain.
Is that the lover of gain has nothing to do with what honest men have to do with?
That's right. But from Socrates' position, all he's going to do is define the right view of everybody.
Going to continue making the same point. So Sock comes back.
But you see, my sweet sir, we have just admitted that making gain is being benefited.
Well, what of that?
Yeah, down.
There is the further point that we have admitted in addition to this that all men wish for good things, always.
Yes.
Then good men likewise wish to have all gains. If these are good things.
Not those gains from which they are bound, Socrates, to suffer harm.
And by suffer harm, do you mean suffer loss? Or
check. Right.
No, I mean just suffer loss.
Well, do you mean suffer loss from gain or from loss?
From both, for they suffer loss from loss and from wicked gain.
Chat that.
Back to.
Yeah, more of wicked gain.
Yeah, it's moralistic way of acquiring.
That's what he's saying.
But he dropped the definition. They've already defined that. That you can't have gain from loss, or can't have loss from gain.
So Sock is not going to say, okay, I'm going to have to deal with that. Looks like.
Pray now. Do you consider that any useful and good thing is wicked?
I do not.
And you admitted. And we admitted a little while ago that gain is the opposite of loss, which is an evil.
I agree.
And that being the opposite of an evil, it is good.
That was our admission.
So you see, you were attempting to deceive me, for you deliberately contradict what we agreed to just now.
No, on my honor, Socrates, on the contrary, it is you who are deceiving me by twisting this way and that so perplexingly in your talk.
Why, surely it would be wrong of me not to obey a good and wise person.
Who is that, and to what are you referring now?
I mean, my and your fellow citizen, Pisistratus. Son Hippocrates, Pisistratus' son,
Pisistratus.
Well, where you put the emphasis. The syllable.
Piss is
emphasis. Right.
Philip. the lot D?
The persuasive soldier.
Oh, this is...
And of the lobby, the lock die, the lobby?
The lobby die.
The lobby die?
The lobby die. The lobby die.
How?
Yeah, the lobby die.
The lobby die.
The lobby die, okay. With the eldest and wisest of his son, and who among the many goodly proofs of wisdom that he showed, first brought the poems of Homer into this country of ours, and compelled the rhapsodes at Panathenaea to recite them in relay, one following one on another, so they still do now. He dispatched a 50-oar galley for Anacreon of Teus, and brought him into our city. Simonides of Ceos he always had about him, prevailing on him by plenteous fees and gifts. All this he did from a wish to educate the citizens, in order that he might have subjects of the highest excellence. For he thought it not right to grudge wisdom to any, so noble and good was he. And when his people in the cities had been educated and were admiring him for his wisdom, he proceeded next with the design of educating those of the countryside to set up figures of Hermes for them along the roads in the midst of the city and every district town. And then, after selecting from his own wise lore, both learnt from others and discovered from himself, the things that he considered the wisest, he threw these into elegiac form and inscribed them on the figures as verses of his own and testimonies of his wisdom, so that in the first place his people should not admire those wise Delphic legends of know thyself and nothing over much, and the other sayings of the sort, but should rather regard as wise the utterances of Hipparchus. And that in the second place, through passing up and down and reading his words and acquiring a taste for his wisdom, they might resort hither from the country for the completion of their education. There are two such inscriptions of his on the left side of each Hermes. There is one in which the god says that he stands in the midst of the city or the township, while on the right side he says, the memorial of Hipparchus. Walk with just intent, or walk with just intent. There are many other fine inscriptions from his poems on other figures of Hermes, and this one in particular are the Steria Road, on the Steria Road, in which he says, the memorial of Hipparchus, see you not afoot. I therefore should never say, sure, to deceive you, who are my friend, or disobey the great Hipparchus, after whose death the Athenians were for 3 years under the despotic rule of his brother Hippias. And you might have heard any one of the earlier periods say that it was only in these years that there was despotism in Athens, and that after all, and that at all other times, the Athenians lived very much as in the reign of Cronus. And the subtler sort of people say that Hipparchus's death was due to cause, supposed by most, the disqualification of the assassin's sister from bearing the basket, for that is a silly motive, but because Harmodius had become the favorite of Aristogeiton and had been educated by him. Thus, Aristogeiton also prided himself on educating people, and he regarded Hipparchus as a dangerous rival. And at that time, it is said, Harmodius happened to be himself in love with one of the handsome and well-born youths of the day. They do tell his name, but I cannot remember it. Well, for a while, this youth admired both Harmodius and Aristogeiton as wise men. But afterwards, when he associated with Hipparchus, he despised them. And they were so overcome with the pain of his disqualification that they slew Hipparchus.
It would seem then, Socrates, either that you do not regard me as your friend, or if you do, that you do not obey Hipparchus. For that you are not deceiving me, though I cannot tell how you contrive it in your talk, is more than I can believe.
Okay. In terms of what we did last time, we analyzed the speech and we came to those conclusions. Now we can go back and look at it in terms of context. Right. So let me ask you, how did Socrates make Hipparchus appear?
Wise.
Moral. Good.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Because he threw in those moralistic terms.
Right. So his friend is using negative judgment. So he's taking, yeah, right, he's taking negative judgments about something in principle that's good. Socrates doing that. He said, I can do that. I can do that without speaking. The man's a bastard. Right? He's the worst tyrant that ever came along. Look at everything he did. I can do it too. I'll do the other extreme, often in glowing terms.
He's desperate him in glowing terms.
Right, a lover of gain for Socrates, a gain has to be a good, if it's really a gain. So lovers of gain are philosophers. Who are they? Now they know gain good. Lovers of gain, says his friend. Because he's been bit, as Steve pointed out, yeah, but severe loss of some kind. Now he says anyone who's a lover of gain must be a crook. Wicked, evil.
Well, carbon, how was it?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Now all of this is to go to Socrates' point. All right, what position? All right, what shall we revoke from what we've said? Is that the conclusion? Sockham's back.
That's right.
Want to do that again? Well, now? Is that the end of the work? Speech on 295?
Well, now, as though we were playing draughts.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, now, as we were playing draughts, as though we were playing draughts, I am willing to let you revoke, as you please, anything you have said in carrying on the discussion, in order that you may not think you are being deceived. So tell me, shall I revoke for you and the statement that all men desire good things?
No, thank you.
Well, that suffering loss or loss is an evil?
No, thank you.
Well, that gain or making gain is the opposite of loss, or suffering loss.
Nor that even.
Well, that making gain as the opposite of loss of evil is the good?
No, not in every case. Let me revoke this one.
Do you think then, it seems, that some gain is good and some evil?
I do.
There we are.
A great dialogue.
What was that, sir?
I said, this is a great dialogue, and they think this might be spurious. The seriousness of this scholar.
Yeah, it doesn't have much more.
I think that was me.
Yeah. That's the, here we go now, right? Fourth position.
Same argument.
But same argument. Still trying to say that. Friend? Want to do that again, friend?
No, not in every case. Let me revoke this one.
You think then it seems that some gain is good and some evil?
I do.
Well then, I revoke so much for you. So let us assume that some gain is good and some other gain evil. But the good sword is no more gain than the evil sword, is it?
What do you mean by this question?
All right, now, we have to make sure that we see his friend, the friend's question. All right. The friend's question is in respect, but the good sword is no more a gain than the evil sword, is it? What do you mean by that?
sort of defining gain.
Now we're going to go through a whole, we're going to go through a whole group of examples to make that point clear. So we have to have the question in our mind. It's still going to be a gain, isn't it? It's whether some of it is, some is judged good and some is evil. It's still going to be a gain. That's not going to change.
Right. The only question is just whether it's evil or good. I mean, whether there's such a thing as one or the other.
It doesn't turn out that way.
Yeah. No, but...
Oh, well then, I revoke so much for you. So let us assume that some gain is good and some other gain evil.
What? Examples.
But the good gain, but the good sword is no more gain than the evil sword, is it?
What do you mean by this question?
I will explain. Is there both good and evil food?
Yes.
And is the one sort more food than the other? Or are they both simply, similarly, the same thing, food?
It's not any more or less food because some of it is good and some of it is bad. It's still food.
And in this respect, does the one differ no wise from the other in being food, but only in the fact of the one being good and the other evil?
Yes.
And so with drink and every other class of things that exist. When some things in any class come to be good and others evil, one thing does not differ from another in that respect, whereby they are the same. For instance, one man, I suppose, is virtuous and another wicked.
Yes.
But neither of them, I conceive, is more or less man than the other, neither the virtuous than the wicked, nor the wicked than the virtuous.
What you say is true.
Then are we to take...
Okay, now that's all the work he's done. And he's got the general principle, doesn't he? When some things in any class come to be good and others evil, one thing does not differ from another in that respect. In what respect? Whereby they are the same. He's got that now. It's a general principle. He nailed it down with all those examples. Okay, let me go back. Sure.
Then are we to take the same view of gain? Also, that both the wicked and the virtuous sword are similarly gained?
Necessarily.
So he who has virtuous gain is no wicked more the gainer than he who has wicked gain. Neither sword is found to be more gain, as we agree.
Yes.
For neither of them has addition of either more or less.
No, indeed.
And how could one do or suffer anything more or less with a thing of this sort that had neither of these additions?
Impossible.
Since, therefore, both of these are gains and gain-making affairs. We must now consider what it can be that leads you to call both of them gains. What is it that you see to be the same in both? Suppose you were to ask me, in those instances that I gave just now, what is it that leads me to call both good food and evil food alike food? I should tell you for this reason. Because both are a dry substance of the body. For that, I am sure you would agree, is what food is, would you not?
I would.
And so, too, about drink, the answer would be on the same lines, that the wet substance of the body, whether it be wholesome or pernicious, has this name of drink. And likewise with the rest. Try, therefore, on your part to imitate my method of answering. When you say that virtuous gain and wicked gain are both gain, what is it that you see to be the same in them, judging it to be the actual element of gain? And if, again, you are yourself unable to answer, just let me put it for you, for your consideration, whether you describe as gain every acquisition that one has acquired either with no expense or is a profit over and above one's expense.
I believe that is what I call gain.
Do you include a case where, after enjoying a banquet at which one has had much good cheer without any expense, one acquires no one?
Upon my word, not I.
Tilt.
Right.
Belching. What?
Tilt. I just, he's in contradiction now. Form of position for his good and evil gain.
But it's a tilt.
Right.
I've had some of that evil gain.
And if what acquired?
Yeah, but, that, yeah, I think that's well said. At 231, right, so try, therefore, on your part, imitate my method of answering. Right. It's instructing anything. Come on, I give these examples, you try to do it. Mm-hmm. Show you how to pull your way through all this.
Do you include a case where, after enjoying a banquet at which one has had much good cheer, without any expense, one acquires an illness?
Upon my word, not I.
And if one acquired health from attending a banquet, would one acquire gain or loss?
Gain.
Hence, gain is not just acquiring any activity.
No, indeed.
Do you mean not if it is illegal? Or will one acquire no gain if one acquires something good?
Apparently one will, if it is good.
And if it is evil, will not one acquire loss?
I think so.
You see then how you are running round again to the same old thing? Gain is found to be good and not evil.
For my part, I cannot tell what to say.
And not without good reason, sir.
Right. He didn't say, I don't know.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Mm-hmm. Right. He didn't reach Amino. Right. No. And he didn't reach the boys' day.
That's right.
No.
And not without good reason, sir. Now answer this further question. You say that if one acquires more than the amount one has spent, it is gain.
I do not mean when it is evil, but if one gets more gold or silver than one has spent.
See what he did? I do not mean when it is evil, right? But if one gets more gold, where does he drop down? He left the moral judgment.
No,
moral
judgment. Right.
Mm-hmm. Right. He dropped the moral judgment. Now he's on more.
Now, I am just going to ask you about that. Tell me, if one spends half a pound of gold and gets double that weight in silver, has one not gained or lost?
Of course you gained. You got more.
Loss, I presume, Socrates, for one's gold is reduced to twice instead of 12 times the value of silver.
But you see, one has got more, worth double, not more than half.
Not in worth, the one being silver and the other gold.
So gain, it seems, must have this addition of worth. At least you now say that silver, though more than gold, is not worth as much, and that gold, though less, is of equal worth.
Assuredly, for that is the case.
Then the valuable is what produces gain, whether it be small or great, and the valueless produces no gain.
Yes.
And by the valuable, you mean simply valuable to possess.
Yes, to possess.
That filled. Oxio.
Pardon?
Worthy.
Yeah, worthy. Mm-hmm. Valuable.
Worthy.
Oops, I'm sorry. Uh-huh. Yes, it is.
Valuable.
The valueless produces no gain. You can see it.
It's still worthy. Axiom.
It's still worthy. Yeah, still axios. That same word that was fit before was worthy translated into the same word.
Worthy.
I saw that as the guy's problem there. He's so quick. He goes with worth in all the examples before that. And then to shift it, even that subtle to valuable there, you know, throws you off. Threw me off. Was he making sock making the distinction between worth and value there? Added a element of confusion.
Because he originally said
worth and value.
And without him.
Well, the grammatical in your head said worthwhile. Right? Grammatical was too.
Mm-hmm.
certainly makes a difference.
Is profitable?
Profitable is beneficial. The same one he had previously for beneficial.
So philemon, it's a feel. It's off of philemon. It's the word he talks about with God, the way he talks in book two. One of the properties that contribute to the divine cause
benefit?
Of well-being of philemon.
Mm-hmm,
that's benefit.
Well, that's what he's doing here.
It's profitable and unprofitable.
Yeah,
that's very good. That puts a whole new level to it, doesn't it?
Because it doesn't fit with profitable.
Yeah. How would you render that sentence then? And again,
like what is worthy?
What is worthy
to possess? Do you mean the beneficial or the unbeneficial? The unbeneficial or the beneficial?
Is that the way it goes? Right.
I don't know. It's just worth. Like both of those are worth. They're forms of worth. That he's the word he's been using for worth all the way along. But, and the worthful, you know, I don't know Greek grammar at all, but anyway, the worthful produces some kind of well-being, or is the cause of well-being, or is an element that has to be present for well-being. I don't know.
What's it say?
Ask a Greek.
Yeah,
sure.
Please, David.
I'm not too sure about your distinction about philemon.
That's what he says in the Republic, you know, in book two, and the good is the cause of well-being. Philemon.
And would you say that it is...
Then
would you say that the valuable is to obtain... unworthy things are what? Not unworthy things, but what's the term used? Unbeneficial things or beneficial things?
Oh, failing.
That just takes it right out of the commercial language.
It gives it
two
words.
Yeah. It elevates the whole discussion.
It gives the divine two words, euphrakia and ophelomon. The one's useful and the other's the cause of well-being. Mm.
Certainly nice. That's a nice shift. And by the worthy, do you mean simply worthy to possess? Yes, to possess. And again, what is worthy to possess, do you mean? What's not beneficial or what's beneficial? Well, it doesn't say profitable. It says beneficial. God. It takes the whole commercial aspect of it right out, doesn't it? Changes the character of the friend.
Mm-hmm. And the beneficial is good.
Yes.
And so, most valiant men, have we not here once more, for the third or fourth time, the admission that what produces gain is good?
So it seems.
Then do you remember the point from which this discussion of ours arose?
I think I do.
In case you do not, I will remind you. You maintained against me that good men do not wish to make all sorts of gains, but only those gains that are good, and not those that are wicked.
Yes.
And now the argument has compelled us to acknowledge that all gains, both small and great, are good.
Yes, it has compelled me, at least, Socrates, rather than persuaded me.
I have been compelled by your logic, but don't think you've persuaded me. You kept angry. You forced me into the corner to admit this.
Well, later on, perhaps it might also persuade you.
Sometimes. Maybe later on.
Now, however, whether you are persuaded or whatever you're feeling, you are at least you at least agree with me that all gains are good, both small and great ones?
Yes, I do admit it.
And you admit that virtuous men all wish for all good things, do you not?
I do.
But, you know, you stated yourself that wicked men love both small and great gains.
I did.
And so, by your account, all men will be lovers of gain, whether they be virtuous or wicked.
Apparently.
Hence, it is not right to reproach anybody with being a lover of gain, for he who makes this reproach is actually such a one himself.
Was that a nice...
Yeah.
You one too, Jim.
Don't call the kettle black.
You're going to be one.
Black the pot should not call the kettle black.
Good.
That was fun. All right. Yeah.
Nice style.
Isn't it though? Yeah. It really has a nice structure to it. That nice ship that was revealed to the Greek as well.
I can see a lot of people.
Because the ending made him appear like just a commercial, just with a commercial interest. It shouldn't fit the beginning.
That's right.
Yeah, because that would make him, as it were, a bad business. Now we can remove that element.
Well, the difference between
how about the next time we go into lovers?
Yeah, sure.
It's the age old question. One is better.
Yeah.
The work is better.
That won't be next Friday for me. I'll be away to Yosemite.
Yosemite.
Uh-huh. So if you guys do it, just leave it on the board. I'll take a look.
You're going to one of those canyons that has a mountain with only half of it there. That's looking.
It is a way of looking at it.
Is half a dome better than none?
Half a dome better than no dome at all, I guess.
Well, we're going through this, right?
By heaven.
Yeah.
Okay, I enjoyed
Pacino was the last time.
Yeah.
Not yet. It's been fun.